Well, good evening, friends, and welcome once again to Revelation Today, The Great Reset. We are excited to study tonight number 13, and the title of our message is The Prescription Reset. How can we live healthier, happier lives from principles that the Bible shares with us for healthy living? It's very, very exciting, and we're going to see how we can be fit for the last days of Earth's history and why it's so important. We want to thank those that are watching online with us. We're welcoming you tonight, and we have folks watching from all around the world, from the Philippines, from Australia, from Asia, from Africa. Almost every continent of the world is watching, and many across North America. So thank you once again for joining us. Just a reminder, on the website, you can go there, revelationtoday.com, and there's all kinds of resources. There are Bible studies for each night's topic. There are also pocketbooks. In fact, tonight, you'll receive the pocketbook, Healthcare God's Way. That will be available to you as a free PDF. You can just click on the button there and download that. There's also the store online. You can check out a number of resources that we have available to you that will help you study more deeply into God's Word. There's also on the store the opportunity to select the DVD set, the Revelation Day DVD set. The pre-order form is there. You can fill that out. Maybe you have a friend that you'd like to share that with, or you'd like to have one for yourself. The pre-order form is available there as well. You can also submit Bible questions, and we want to encourage you to do that. We've been answering those night after night. We have some exciting topics that are coming up as well. Our next several nights, we're going to study America in prophecy, the Antichrist of Bible prophecy, and the mark of the beast. These are subjects, friends, you do not want to miss. I also want to recommend to you a website for children. We've mentioned this before. We want to mention it again. MyPlaceWithJesus.com has all kinds of resources and studies for children that may be in your life. Maybe you have children or grandchildren, nieces or nephews that you like to share that with. Those are very valuable to you as well. And as always, we encourage you to share the website with others on your social media through texting. You may have some friend that needs encouragement. Maybe somebody you've met is interested in the Bible. We encourage you to share that with them so that they can also take part in this Bible study adventure. To those here live in Chattanooga, has been a blessing. Yes, it has. We have received letters from folks around the world saying how blessed they are from Revelation Today, The Great Reset. So once again, thank you for joining us. Well, this time, we're going to invite Pastor John Bradshaw to come out and join us on the platform here. We have some Bible questions that we're going to answer. Pastor John, welcome tonight once again.
Thank you very much. Good to be here. Good to see you. Welcome. Thanks for joining us. Great to have you here for Revelation Today, The Great Reset.
All right. We have some questions from previous topics and some random ones tonight as well.
Okay.
The first one is, why is it that God seems to be so hard and harsh in the Old Testament, but so loving and kind in the New Testament? I thought God never changes.
Well, I think you're right. God never changes. And if we consider the way God acted in the Old Testament, you'll find that Noah found grace in the eyes of God. Lot found grace in the eyes of God. God was gracious in the Old Testament. Now, undoubtedly, there were some stern moments in the Old Testament, but they certainly occurred in the New as well. Did you hear about this couple named Ananias and Sapphira who came to, well, it wasn't church, who fronted up one day and told a rather considerable lie? One of them dropped dead, and a short time later, so did the other. So what I want you to say is not that God causes people to drop dead. That's not the point. But in the Old Testament, there were judgments, and in the New Testament, there were judgments. In the Old Testament, there was grace. It was in the Old Testament, God spoke of his people and said, I will speak comfortably to her and allure her. Those are beautiful words. A new heart also will I give you. A new spirit will I put within you. I know the thoughts I have towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you hope and a future. This is Old Testament. And over in the New Testament, the wages of sin is death. Fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. New Testament. So you will find the love of God all the way through the Bible. And by the way, the judgments of God are in fact a representation and a manifestation of the love of God. They're not mutually exclusive one from the other. Grace old and new, love old and new, law old and new, judgments old and new. God is one God, same God from Genesis 1:1 all the way through to the end of Revelation chapter 22.
Amen. Fantastic answer. Number two, regarding baptism, if a person were on their deathbed and accepted Jesus as their Savior, but couldn't be baptized by immersion, would they be lost?
Oh, absolutely. God would say, sorry, I'm sorry you had terminal cancer or you couldn't walk. That's your problem. You know I'm being facetious here. No, listen, God, if nothing else, is a God of consummate common sense. There was a certain thief, bad egg. He was hanging on the cross. His buddy over there was casting curses and imprecations at Jesus. This man said, hey, no, that's not right. This fellow's done nothing wrong. As for us, we're getting our just desserts. And he turned to Jesus. He said, Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom. Jesus said, how can I do that? Get off the cross. Run and be baptized. Maybe you could make it to the River Jordan. Now, you know, Jesus said, I tell you right now, you will be with me in paradise. So there are moments. I know no one's looking for something to hide behind. If you can, you should. If you can, you ought to want to be baptized. This is God washing away your sins. This is God pouring the Spirit of God into your life. This is you making a public declaration before God and the universe. I have chosen Jesus. He is my Lord and Savior. I'm on God's side in this thing. That's what you want. No question about that. But if you can't, if you cannot, God understands. Now, I've spoken to people. You have too, I'm sure. I've met people. I'm sure you have too. People who are unwell, deathly ill, people who are unable to walk, people who are paralyzed and live their lives in a wheelchair, who have been baptized. We've seen people baptized wheelchair and all. You know, when you can, you will. When you love God, you love to do what pleases God. But no, please don't think for a moment that God is unreasonable. He's not. And again, I know that no one's looking for a way out. Why would you? But if you can, you would. There's no question about it. If you cannot, then you cannot. And what can you do in that situation?
Absolutely. If we can, we should.
Yeah.
All right, number three, the Bible refers to the soul as basically a person with God's breath. But what about Matthew 10:28, where Jesus says God can destroy both soul and body in hell? Those seem to be two separate things.
Well, they are two separate things. Body and breath is really what Jesus was referring to in Matthew 10 and verse 28. You know, you have, and I wonder if this is why Jesus said it. I don't know, but I wonder. You have people who believe that when you die, your soul goes somewhere, which of course it doesn't, because a soul is what you are. It's not what you had. You got to remember that. A soul is what you are, body and breath combined together. That's a living soul. So at death, the body goes back to the ground or wherever it, you know, I don't want to get graphic here, but let's just assume it goes back to the ground. That breath, God has that. He holds that. He holds within himself the power to enable you to live again. Now, when the Bible speaks of body and soul, it's saying body and breath. That's what it means. The word soul is translated from numerous Greek words. Let's not go all through all of them right now. But this is what Jesus is saying. So back to my point. You got people who believe when you die, your soul goes off to hell, and I don't know how you burn a vapor, but your soul, no, Jesus was saying hell isn't for disembodied spirits, it is for people bodily, body and breath, the whole unit, everything a person is. Yeah, you want to avoid that, and you can through faith in Jesus Christ. So Jesus in Matthew 10 and verse 28 was not saying there's a separation somehow between the physical person and the whatever this wispy thing might be. He is saying body and breath will all be destroyed together in the lake of fire. It's serious.
That's
really
the point he's making, is that hell is the final, eternal non-existence of a person, the destruction of them. So very much he makes the point there.
By the way, how can anybody really have peace with the idea that God would actually burn someone forever and ever and ever? I know what people say. People will say something like, well, that's what I believe, and that's that. But why would you believe that if it doesn't teach it in the Bible? Well, it talks about the soul of the smoke of their torment ascending up forever and ever. Yeah, it does not say they're going to be burned forever and ever. It's talking about the smoke of their torment. It's talking about the consequences of what happens to them. It's all about the effects of hellfire burning forever. Why would you want to believe? Why would you want to believe that God is love, but if you don't love him back, he will burn you forever? That idea has created atheists who are thinking people have said, why would I serve a God like that? Why would you believe it? You don't have to, and it isn't true. God is love. Yes, the wicked will ultimately be blotted out of existence. That's what they would want. The wicked wants to be blotted out of existence because they wouldn't be happy in heaven. But to burn someone forever and ever, you're just making God to be a torturer and a tyrant, and that is not the Christian God.
That's right. Number four, I want to be baptized, yes, but I am deathly afraid of water. What should I do?
Well, Nike gave you good advice. Just do it. But let me speak with a little more sensitivity here. Maybe you are absolutely, deathly, phobically, I cannot do it, afraid. Not many people are in that situation.
That's true.
Not many. I remember being in Lexington, Kentucky, and speaking with a lady who said, I desperately want to be baptized, but I cannot. I'm desperately afraid of water. And I said, well, what? So how about when you go swimming? Don't swim. Well, what do you do about taking a shower? She said, I hate it, and I do it with great difficulty. And she described some of the contortions she went through to have a shower without freaking out completely. She said, if you were to put $1 million on the bottom of that pool of water, I wouldn't go in. You know, if you're in that situation, I kind of think that God understands. Now, someone's going to say, just have faith. Yeah, but irrational fears are irrational fears. And if you're deathly afraid of spiders, I can't tell you, just have faith. Hang out with the spiders. If you're terribly afraid of heights, I'm not going to take you up onto a tall building and ask you to peer over the edge and ask you to get over your fear of heights. Sometimes there's just a fear. Now, what I believe that God can get you through that. I do. I really do. You can tell yourself, water's not going to hurt me. You can tell yourself that. But I cannot be the arbiter of your experience. I cannot decide what your tolerance level is, what your threshold is. If that's the case, if you're thinking about getting baptized, why don't you talk to me or Wes and explain this? We might be able to encourage you and reassure you. And if not, then undoubtedly God will understand your situation and love you fully anyway.
Our last question for tonight, do I have to be perfect to be baptized? I feel like I have to clean myself up before I can be worthy enough. I also hesitate because I know I will likely sin after my baptism, and I don't want to ruin what God has done for me.
Yeah, if you wait to clean yourself up, you could be waiting a very, very long time. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We are sinners, and you cannot clean yourself up. Only God can do that. If you wait to be perfect, you will never be baptized. When you accept Jesus, he gives you his righteousness and its perfect righteousness. That's your perfection. Now, let's dig down a little deeper, because it could be that somebody says, well, is it okay that I'm a drug addict and a wife beater and immoral, like running around on my husband or whatever it is? Maybe if I don't have to be perfect, I can be baptized in spite of that. No, because the Bible says you are to repent. And to repent is to be sorrowful for sin and to turn away from sin. Now, I know the devil gets in the details. Well, what do you mean turn away? What I mean is turn away. But you can't promise God you're never going to slip again or never going to fall again. I can guarantee you that you will, because that's just how life goes. We are growing in the grace of God. Don't wait to get perfect, but if you do need to repent, do repent. If there are wrongs you need to make right, make them right. If there's some things you ought to give up, give them up. Why would you hang on to them anyway? But by all means, accept Jesus. That's where your perfection is. Don't wait until you feel like you are absolutely sinless, because A, you'd be wrong, and B, you may be lying to yourself, and that'd be another sin. So don't wait for perfection. Your perfection isn't Jesus. Wait till you are ready, and you're ready when you've accepted Christ and repented. Then don't wait for anything.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor John. And keep submitting those Bible questions. We're excited when we get them. We are thankful that we can respond with a Bible answer, because we want people to have answers, and only the Bible can. We don't have all the answers, but the Bible does, and we will do those as well as we can. All right, at this point, we're going to have another special number from our friend Jessica Faraz entitled, I Will Go.
Thank you. will go. I will go.
Oh, wasn't that beautiful? Good evening again, everybody. We are going to pray and expect that God will speak to us tonight. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, in Jesus' name, we approach your throne of grace. We do so confidently. You see, we believe that there is a God in heaven who wishes to communicate with us. We believe these are late moments in the history of this world. We believe that the last movements will be rapid movements, and we want to be prepared in Christ, yielded and armed. That is, defended, shielded, strengthened by the truth of your word. So speak to us again, we pray and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. I suspect you have heard the name Hippocrates. Hippocrates was a doctor. A Greek doctor lived about 400 years before the birth of Jesus. He was clearly a man of some very considerable intellect. That having been said, Hippocrates gets a little bit of credit for saying things that he didn't actually say. He's the man who's responsible, we believe, for writing the Hippocratic Oath, which many people would claim says, first do no harm, but that's not actually in the Hippocratic Oath. You could deduce that sentiment from it were you to read the Hippocratic Oath, but it does not say, first do no harm. Hippocrates never wrote, more than likely never ever even uttered those words. And if you ever thought that Hippocrates said, let your food be your medicine and your medicine be your food, you'd be mistaken. No one knows exactly where that came from. It certainly didn't come from Hippocrates. However, there's a lot of truth in that idea, inasmuch as there are foods that contain tremendous healing properties. Now, let's think about some of them. Leafy green vegetables, kale, spinach, arugula, that type of food item. Very high in vitamin C. We talk about eating oranges for vitamin C. You could eat blueberries or kiwi fruit. I would recommend that. Support the New Zealand kiwi fruit industry, if you would. You could eat leafy greens loaded with vitamin C. They are loaded with other vitamins as well, and they contain antioxidants. In fact, if you look closely, you can see the antioxidants in them. You see that? Antioxidants protect your cells from damage. We are simply beings made up of a lot of cells, so antioxidants are a great help, and you need them, and it's wise to eat for outcome. Eat for strength, the Bible says. Eat with these things in mind. Berries, extraordinarily good for you, loaded with fiber, filled with vitamins and antioxidants. And by the way, just look at them. They look good, don't they? They look like the sort of thing that you would enjoy eating. Same with nuts and seeds. They're packed full of protein. They're loaded with healthy fats and vitamins. Sweet potatoes, great source of carbohydrates. They've got vitamins and minerals. All the things you really want to need. And I need to tell you this, the simple oat is amazingly nutritious. It contains soluble fiber, very good for you. They are filling, and so you eat a bowl full of oats. You don't want to eat a bunch of junk after that. Help you with weight loss and on, the simple oat. There is a long list of foods that are incredibly good for you. They're easy to find. They're easy to eat, easy to prepare. They're inexpensive. And so here's a question. If they're all so good, apples and whole grains and walnuts and avocados and broccoli and onions and lentils and so on and so on, if they're all so good, so easy to find, so simple to eat, so relatively inexpensive, at least many of them are, why in the world are we so sick? If there's so much good stuff just waiting there on the shelf, then you can buy it and enjoy it. I think we both know the reason. And that's because so many of us prefer to eat food that looks like this. Deep fry it, slather it in butter, cook it in oil, drown it in salt. And if you do that, what in the world can you expect? Here's what we do. We take perfectly good water, add artificial flavoring, and then put not one, not two, three, four, five, six, seven, or eight, as many as 9 teaspoons of sugar into a can of soda, and then we drink gallons of it, and we wonder why it is that we are so ill. Your favorite breakfast cereal, or the one you feed your kids or grandkids, likely contains enough sugar to sink a battleship. You feed that to the kids in the morning, and then you wonder why in the world they cannot sit still in school all day long. And you think they're badly behaved, but they're not. The parent is badly behaved. It's bad behavior giving your kids junk like that. I made a couple of notes. I hope you won't mind me looking on my phone. It is easy to find breakfast cereal in the supermarket, and they put this at eye level for the kids so the kids see it and go, ah. That contains per cup of breakfast cereal, 17 grams of sugar. That is 1/3 of one's recommended daily sugar intake. That is 4 1/4 teaspoons of sugar. And then there are people who add sugar to sugary breakfast cereal. I just don't understand it. But that's 1 cup. When was the last time anybody ate 1 cup of breakfast cereal? So by the time the kid grabs the box and fills the bowl, that might be 2, 3, or 4 cups. And if that's so, if it's 3 cups, how many do we say? That would be almost 13 teaspoons of sugar. And you're just so happy that little Johnny or little Susie ate all their breakfast cereal. Oh, it's time to think again. There are other breakfast cereals that contain even more sugar. You would just about be better off eating the box and throwing away the cereal. Nutritionally, you would just about be better off. I made another note. You can easily find energy drinks, an energy drink with 9 teaspoons of sugar in it. Where's the energy coming from? I read this. This is not a brand, but this was a description. An energy lift juice. Energy lift juice. Oh, who doesn't want that? You're feeling a little slow, a little sluggish, a little tired. Give me some of that energy lift juice with its 21 teaspoons of sugar in it. That's the size of a Coke can. And it was 21 teaspoons of sugar. You'd think it'd be sludge with that much sugar in it. Have mercy. And you drink one, and then another, and then another. And by the time you ate a chocolate bar to go along with it, oh, your poor body is screaming out in protest. God did something good for us. He created wheat, but then some bright spark took out all the roughage, took out all the fiber, took out all the bran, and made bread out of highly refined white flour. Now, what happens is that white bread digests really quickly, causing significant fluctuations in your blood sugar. It'll make it spike. And you don't have to be a doctor of any kind to realize that that is far from ideal. Now, I need to say this, and you know it already, it's not hard to figure this out, particularly if you have a brain and the capacity to read. You might want to take to reading labels on the side of the products that you buy and then making your decisions based on what you see on those labels. Now, I'm not ignoring the fact that some people just have complexities with their health. I know that. My own father-in-law, tremendously healthy fellow, walked several miles a day, ate very, very well, had a stroke, boom, debilitated. But he is one of four boys, all of whom have heart difficulties. Their dad died really young. This was a congenital heart thing. This was hereditary. Understand that? Sure. You can get sick. You can just have issues. So let's understand that you can eat really well and still get sick. But my word, you ought to be thinking about eating well so that you don't. You shouldn't be planning to hasten the sickness. We understand something about cause and effect. If you smoke, you are going to damage your lungs and shorten your lifespan. You just are. The odds of developing lung cancer go through the roof. If you drink alcohol, you are in the process of causing a long list of problems. And by the way, thinking of soda, did you ever do that thing when you were a kid? And you took an old coin, an old dirty coin, put it in maybe a saucer or a cup or something, and you poured that certain soda drink in there? And then you went away and you came back a while, and now that coin is just as shiny, bright as new because the acid in the drink or whatever it was ate up all the gunk and grime, dirt, left that thing pristine like it had just come from the mint. Did you ever stop and wonder what in the world that stuff does to your insides? I hope you've given that some consideration. The human body is fragile. Often things can go wrong. There is so much that can go wrong. Notice the Bible says in the Psalm 139, that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Made. Frequently, if you would buy a machine, an appliance, if you buy an automobile, something that was made, manufactured, it would come with a user guide. Do this, don't do that. Put this fuel in it, not that fuel in it. Put this kind of oil in it. What we need is a owner's manual for the human body. You know that tonight I'm going to tell you that there is one. I understand even children will get cancer. Older people frequently coming down with dementia, debilitating diseases like Parkinson's and ALS. We don't frankly know where they come from. We don't know what to do about them. It's difficult to treat them. There's no cure. Yet we pray and hope that there will be one. They frequently just strike at random. So I think, and you think too, that it's best that we are careful with what we've got. I touched on this a little bit last night. The CDC reports that 85% of Americans over the age of 60 use prescription drugs. Almost 1 in 5 children under the age of 12 is using a prescription drug. That's amazing. And the most commonly used prescription drugs for people aged between 20 and 59, what class of drugs? Antidepressants. Isn't that stunning? Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm certainly not being critical. If a person needs a certain medication, thank God. If it provides you the help that you need, wonderful. Remember, medications often bring complications, but as far as possible, we know that if you gotta take them, you do. Frequently, your life will be extended. Your life may be saved, changed for the better. Oh, I'm not railing against that. I'm simply pointing out what you know, and that is that we're really sick. And I don't think that that was God's intention, not ever, based on what we read in the Bible. What's so wrong that we are in this healthcare mess? And it's a mess. About 660,000 people die every year in the United States from heart disease. Every other Western country, the statistics equate to being about the same. In this country, it's one in every four deaths. One in four, a quarter of all deaths, heart disease. It costs the country about $365 billion every year. You know that's a lot. There's a heart attack every 40 seconds in this country. Again, every other Western country. Canada, same north of the American border. Australia, Great Britain, New Zealand, France, Germany, basically all the same. Heart disease is just one of many lifestyle-related diseases, causing huge problems in this world. Americans consume, on average, it is said, about 3,400 milligrams of salt a day. Now, I don't know if that sounds like a lot to you, but the recommended daily salt intake is 2,300, actually less than 2,300. So, on average, between us, we're eating about 50% more salt than we need to be eating. You can easily get 1,800 milligrams of salt in one burger at a very accessible burger restaurant, one near you. One burger chain sells a burger containing 2,800 milligrams of salt. And you know that whoever ate that burger is eating a whole lot else during the day. Salt has been described as the deadliest ingredient in our food supply. Deadly. Believe it or not, one restaurant sells one meal containing, now remember, less than 2,300 is ideal. One restaurant sells a meal containing 13,000 milligrams of salt. Six times the amount of salt you should get in one day in one meal. Even if you were to share that meal, split it with a friend, that is a hideous amount of salt, revealing to us that we're just killing ourselves, basically. And this is not what God envisaged when he said to Adam and Eve back in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 29, "See, I have given you every herb that yields seed, which is on the face of all the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seed. To you it shall be for food." Now that's right back in the beginning. That's God writing the menu. But over there in Genesis chapter 3, the devil said to Eve, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die." Serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die." God said, "Eat this, don't eat that." The devil said, "Eat it all. Eat whatever you want." And death and misery and sin followed in its wake. If only Adam and Eve had listened to what God said. In the book of Acts, there's another prescription for good health. It's fascinating, this. You will find that the vast majority of people, even people who say, "I am a New Testament Christian. My faith starts in the book of Acts." Oh, no, it doesn't. You read this. They had a major church council, the Jerusalem Council. It was convened to answer some very sticky questions, some thorny questions, to settle some disputes in the nascent Christian church. And in answer to one of these questions, the reply came, Acts 15, starting in verse 19, "I judge that we should not trouble those from among the Gentiles who are turning to God, but that we write to them to abstain from things polluted by idols, from sexual immorality, from things strangled, and from blood." That's pretty clear, isn't it? God said, "Don't eat blood." Now, why would he say that? Well, he's just repeating what was said back in the Old Testament, in the book of Leviticus, where God said, "The life of the flesh is in the blood. And you eat that, you're getting impurities, you're getting sicknesses, you are imbibing diseases." God said, in the book of Acts, "You don't want to eat blood." Oh, have mercy. I remember growing up in my home, there were two things, only two, that my mother would allow me to not eat. One was tripe. Does anybody here know what tripe is? What's it made from? The lining of a sheep's stomach, or maybe another animal. For us, it was a sheep's stomach. It stunk. It was hideous. It tasted like sin. I just couldn't eat it. And my mother, God bless her, she would say, okay, John, you don't have to eat that. The other was blood sausage. Got any idea what blood sausage was or is? It's sausage made from blood. Blood and maybe oats and maybe some other garbage. Not that the oats are garbage, but by the time they're soaked in blood, they're pretty awful. We'd slice these thin slices like this. Blood. Blood. I wish my mother and father had read Acts chapter 15, and they would never have foisted the blood sausage. My dad was raised on a farm. They had some pretty bad habits on that farm, I think. And so my dad was just as happy that the kids would leave the blood sausage to him so he could eat the stuff himself. Ah, mercy. So God in the Bible says, don't eat that, do eat this, don't eat blood. Nowhere did God say, don't eat fruit. You see in the book of Acts where God said, now don't eat the pineapple, leave the avocados alone. I don't want you eating rhubarb. Stay away from cauliflower. God didn't say that. He recommended the good stuff, and he urged us to stay away from the bad stuff. And this thread goes all the way through the Bible. Look at 3 John verse 2, where it says, beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. I want you to look at that carefully. Do you see? God draws a connection between your physical health and your spiritual well-being. Your physical and your spiritual health are intertwined. This goes right by a lot of people, and you don't want it to go right by you because you are getting ready for heaven. One day Jesus is going to come back, and surely there'll be people who are here tonight who will be alive and on the circle of the earth when Jesus returns. And so we want every advantage and as few disadvantages as we can find. Doesn't this sort of thing seem sensible, especially given the environment or the climate in which we find ourselves today? We are caught ensnared in a public health crisis. And God from the very beginning said, I want you to be in the best health possible, because God wants us not only to live, but to live forever. Jesus connected our eternal life with our diet when he said in John chapter 6 and verse 56, he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him. He was clear. Eat well, live forever. Now here, of course, he is speaking about your spiritual diet. There's no question about that. No question about that. He said, backing up a little bit in the same chapter, we go to verse 53, Jesus said, most assuredly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. So here Jesus spoke of a diet. This is a spiritual diet, I understand. We are to eat right, eat his flesh, drink his blood. We will not die, but instead we will live forever. This is a spiritual problem too, but certainly a physical problem. The problem is too many of us just love junk food. It tastes good. Now some of this is seeing in the picture, a little sickly. Couldn't eat too much of that, I don't think. If you just ate dessert on special occasions, you'd be fine. Nothing wrong with a little white bread, nothing wrong with a little dessert, a little sugar. The Bible speaks about eating a little honey, which is not refined, understand that. So a little sweetener, oh, that's okay. But you got to get that right, or before long, things are starting to go wrong. People don't operate the off button very well. I'm one of them. You might be too. We are good at on, wide open, bring it on. I want more. I want to drink it. I want to eat it. I want to consume it. I want to have it and enjoy it. We're not quite as good at restraint, unfortunately. Now again, I'll say this just to make sure you have heard me. No one's referring to people who have difficult conditions or difficult health problems that make moderation difficult or that make good health difficult. I understand that. And if you've gone and earned yourself some health problems the old-fashioned way, well, you know, that's that. And maybe the clock can't be turned back. That's all right. You do what you can with what you got. So I don't want you to think for a minute that I would want to be singling you out if you have some kind of a health challenge. Sometimes, as I mentioned earlier, there's just nothing you can do about it. Sometimes. But generally, we know the challenges, we recognize them, and few people do not understand that if you make healthy choices versus unhealthy choices, you end up with better outcomes. God would want us to make good decisions. In fact, surrender our decision-making process to Him. So look at where this really matters. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, starting in verse 19. Don't you know that your body is the, you tell me please, is the what? Temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own. The Bible says you were bought at a price. So therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's, which belong to God. So notice, here's why this really matters. You start studying prophecy and discussing prophecy, you're preparing for the end of time. And God says, if you're getting ready for heaven, get ready for heaven. Give yourself every advantage. Look after yourself. Make good choices. You want to stay out of the ER as much as you can, out of the ICU if you possibly can. You want to stay clear of the lifestyle diseases, and many of them can be avoided. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31, the Bible says, whether therefore you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. So you can eat and drink to the glory of God. Over in Revelation chapter 14, part of the last gospel message to go to the world, fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come, and that's where we are right now. It is not easy to give glory to God while you are destroying the high point of His creation. And so God says, whatever you do, eat, drink, whatever, do it for the glory of God. This matters to God because it impacts you spiritually. And that's what is most important. Give you a Bible example of this. Long before he wrote the book of Daniel, young Daniel was taken from his home in Jerusalem and as a prisoner brought to the city of Babylon and the kingdom of Babylon, removed from his home, captured, taken as a slave. And no sooner did he get there, you read about it in Daniel 1, that he was offered Babylonian food. He wouldn't eat it. It says in verse 8, Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Evidently, there was something about this food that wasn't pleasing to God. Maybe it was unclean. Maybe it was unhealthful. Perhaps it had been sacrificed to idols. But you find later in the Bible that Paul writes, you don't have to worry too much about that. Whatever it was, and it seems this was unhealthy, bad for him food, Daniel said, I'm not going to eat that because it violates the principles of heaven. Daniel kept his body pure out of love for and respect for God, out of honor for God. And as a result, God used Daniel to communicate to the human family some of the most profound communications ever uttered. If Daniel had dived into the king's food and drink, there is no question but that Daniel would never have become Daniel the prophet. It just wouldn't have happened. This is profoundly good news. God wants to keep us well, lengthen our lives, and expand our capacity to connect with God on a deeply spiritual level. Daniel kept his mind clear. He kept his body well, and he excelled spiritually. He didn't just make it. He didn't just make the grade or slide on by. He excelled spiritually. Who do you think is egging you on, urging you to put garbage in your body, urging you to confuse your mind, urging you to slow yourself down, get sluggish, unfit, unwell, unhealthy? Who is into that? Who's the one who says, no, you want that, it'll cause you harm? You say, but it'll cause me harm. And the devil says, but it smells so good. You know, don't you, that the good chefs know that in order to make things more palatable, I read to some New York City big shot chef, just add more salt, add more fat. Add more salt, add more fat. Human beings are pretty easy to please if you got enough salt and you got enough fat. It's not God who said, take all the good stuff, all the vegetables, and deep fry them and have all that fat stick to the inside of your arteries, and more sticks and more sticks and more sticks, so your artery narrows and narrows and narrows. You say, oh my, I think I'm having, why did that happen? Why did that happen? That's because you and your deep fryer are on a first name basis. That's why that happened. Again, little caveat, sometimes it happens. Not diet or lifestyle related. Sometimes. But for the most part, we know. It's not God that urges you to keep consuming that which ultimately will really hurt you. Likewise, God never encouraged us to use illegal drugs. Why? They damage the mind. You can become addicted to them. They do a great amount of harm. Now, thank the Lord, addictions can be beaten. And there are a great many people who have beaten their addictions, and we are grateful to God for that. People who have turned their lives around. But addictions, particularly illegal drug addictions, really harm the mind. What I find fascinating is that people will say, oh, surely it's okay to drink alcohol, particularly a little alcohol. University of Washington released a study a few years ago in which they said, listen, I'm quoting now, there is no safe level of drinking alcohol. They say, if you drink this much and cut it back to this much, that's not safe. It only becomes safe when you get rid of it. These are what scientists say. Hey, wait a minute, Bradshaw. Aren't you forgetting that red wine is good for you? No. Red grapes are good for you. People say resveratrol is good for the human body. Now, there are studies that say that might just be overblown. You know who wants you to think that drinking red wine is good for your health? The folks who sell red wine. If you want to get the good stuff out of red wine, drink red juice. It's in there too. Eat red grapes. And you can do that without getting the alcohol and the hangover and all the garbage that goes along with it. That talk about moderate drinking is okay for you, right? No, the Bible doesn't back that up. In fact, the Proverbs say, Proverbs 20 and verse 1, that wine is a mocker. Strong drink is raging, and whoever is led astray thereby is not wise. You know that alcohol is dangerous. Just think, traffic deaths, car wrecks, the injuries that alcohol causes. Think about the domestic violence that alcohol fuels. There are women right now hiding for their lives at a shelter who might suggest to you that your support of the alcohol industry landed them where they are. I tell you this, the folks who sell, manufacture that stuff have blood on their hands. And no need to mince words, blood on their hands. Prisons are filled with people who've committed crimes while under the influence of alcohol. Alcohol is connected to immorality. And we all know that, no question about it. Now, by the way, you might say, hey, listen, man, I just have a beer a week or a glass of wine every once in a great while. And so you're calling, no, I get it. I understand. That's your prerogative if that's what you choose to do. Now, you're supporting a terrible, terrible industry, no question about that. Are you damaging yourself a whole lot? I don't know. But I can tell you that the people who do the study say that there's no amount of alcohol that's safe. It goes to work destroying brain cells right away. As for me and my house, well, we don't have enough brain cells to be run around destroying the few. I can hear the other three members of my family saying, speak for yourself. And so maybe that's what I'm doing. And I would challenge you, if all you drink is a little alcohol, you ain't going to miss it. Be easy to give it up. Let it go. And you know that you would be honoring God. So alcohol, what do we do about that? Well, didn't Jesus drink wine? Think about what he told Timothy. 1 Timothy 5, verse 3, no longer drink only water, but use a little wine for your stomach's sake and for your frequent infirmities. Could Paul have been recommending alcohol based on what the Bible says about alcohol? No. Here, when he spoke about wine, he wasn't talking about alcohol. He was talking about grape juice. Grape juice may help you if you have, let's say, intestinal distress. Cabernet Sauvignon or Johnny Walker Black Label, not likely to help a whole lot. Just not. And then there's the idea that Jesus turned water into wine at the wedding feast. Well, not the idea. He really did. He turned water into... Here's the thing. In English, we get the word wine. Well, often what you do is you go to the original language and that'll solve it for you. So in the Greek, the word for wine is oinos, and that means wine. And in Hebrew, the word is yayin, and that means wine. It doesn't differentiate. So you must take a look at the context, you understand. And when you do, then you would understand that the one who said, don't drink wine because it's a mocker, stay away from alcohol because of all the harm it's going to cause, certainly isn't going to show up at a wedding and say, drinks are on me. There would have been about 100 people at the wedding feast in Cana, the experts say. Jesus created 125 gallons or so of wine. Maybe that's why Jesus said, sometimes your ox ends up in the ditch. You can imagine these drunken guys driving their ox carts home, all over the road. No, Jesus created juice. Ah, but it was good. Have you never had good juice? Does it have to be alcohol before it can be declared to be the best that a person has ever had? No, if Jesus poured you a glass of water, it would be the best water you ever had if it came from the hand of Jesus. So at the wedding feast, Jesus wasn't getting people all liquored up. He just wasn't. The key you're looking for is right here in Isaiah chapter 65, where the prophet wrote, as the new wine is found in the, tell me, cluster, that would be a cluster of what? As the new wine is found in the cluster, and that would be, we are adding parenthetically, a cluster of grapes. And one says, do not destroy it, for a blessing is in it. So will I do for my servant's sake that I may not destroy them all. The blessing in the wine is the wine found in the cluster. That's grapes. You can go at that all day long and derive very little harm and a great amount of betterment. But that which you buy from the liquor store, we could not safely or responsibly say the same. And of course, smoking is not in the will of God. We know that. God wants what's best for you. Jesus died to separate you from the habits that would destroy you. You just got to listen to the Surgeon General. The warnings that you see on cigarette packets, they are graphic and they are unambiguous. It's harmful. Now, one thing that people don't want to talk about, because it is now the drug of choice for 9 out of 10 Americans, is caffeine. I'll speak about that briefly because I've already lost enough friends this evening. The good thing is, if you're anything, any kind of Christian at all, then you will know that it is your duty to forgive me. So I'm hoping that when the dust settles, you'll be okay. One thing that many people don't know about caffeine is that it negatively affects the level of the neurotransmitters in your brain. That's what keeps your brain in balance. And that's why caffeine consumption can lead to a lot of disorders, including mental disorders, including depression. Experts will tell you that caffeine is a mind-altering drug. So what did Jesus come into this world? Listen, I know what people think. Oh, how could I be happy without my cup of joe? How could I be happy without my wine? How could I be... I do want to say this. May I? I don't know that I've ever really even said this in public. But if you can't be happy without wine and caffeine, you got a shallow life. It's a shallow life. if that's what is absolutely essential for your happiness. Now, I didn't say you're a shallow person if those things make you happy. Oh, I expect many or most people here this evening have drunk one or the other or both, and perhaps some of us in copious quantities, and we understand the happiness one would derive. But to think that you can't be happy without the things that God wants you to leave out of your life, that's a certain type of madness. Of course you can be happy without them. You can learn to get along without certain things, particularly if you know that they're not good for you. Jesus came to give us an abundant life. John 10, verse 10, I have come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. And it was God's plan from the beginning. Remember, Methuselah lived to be 969 years old following God's plan. Evidently, it was a pretty good plan. From Methuselah's day to our day, oh, there have been some big changes. Big changes. But remember the dietary plan they followed back then. Genesis 1:29, I've given you every herb that yields seed, which is on the face of the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seed, to you it will be for food. They didn't eat animals in the beginning. They just didn't. Animals weren't permitted to be included in the diet until later. And even when they were, God moderated the practice. Genesis 7, verse 2, he said to Noah, when Noah was fixing to get on the ark, you shall take with you seven each of every clean animal, a male and his female, two each of animals that are unclean, a male and his female. So did you see what God said? In Genesis, some animals are declared to be what? Clean, while others were said to be unclean. There was a real difference. Now, did God imagine that his people would eat just every last creature that there was? Oh, think about it. Just think about it. I think common sense and reason dictate that the answer would be no, but let's look at this. God gave more information a little bit later in the Bible. Leviticus chapter 11, verse 3, among the animals, whatever divides the hoof, having cloven hooves and chewing the cud, that you may eat. Now, those were the clean. Split hoof, and it chews the cud. That, God said, you may eat. And then the next verse starts with the word, nevertheless, however, but these shall you not eat among those that chew the cud or those that have cloven hooves. The camel, because it chews the cud, but it doesn't have a split hoof, it's unclean to you. Now, I'm sorry if you were planning to go home tonight and have a camel burger or some grilled camel, but God says camels are unclean. They have a pad on the bottom of their foot. They're unclean according to God. The next verse says that rabbits are unclean. So we're getting a little closer to home. I don't think too many folks around here are dining on camel, but maybe rabbits. Take it a little further, verse 7 of Leviticus 11 says, and the swine. Now that's Miss Piggy, isn't it? Right there. Though it divides the hoof, having cloven hooves, yet it doesn't chew the cud. Therefore, it's unclean to you. So pigs are unclean. And now we have brought this thing home. Boy, I should just run from this as quickly as I can. I hope you remember, but I'm having too much fun now. We're talking about ham and bacon and spare ribs. Anybody here has never eaten spare ribs? Okay, some. Oh, you don't know what you're missing. They're so good. I was in my early 20s when I discovered spare ribs. It's just not a New Zealand thing. Oh, man, they're good. And then I read the Bible. I said, oh, no. No, it took me like 22 years to find spare ribs, and a year later I'm reading in the Bible that they're unclean. And I wondered if God would enter into a sort of a negotiation with me. I said, if I could have the ribs, I would happily yield the Brussels sprouts. You could have them. But God wasn't interested in my negotiation. Can't understand why. Well, actually, I can. I saw a shocking report must have seen this on TV, perhaps it was online, about a woman who was told that she had a brain tumor. And so they were operating to remove the brain tumor. And they discovered that when they looked into her brain, they found a parasitic worm in her brain. Now, people have spoken about the trichina larvae for quite some time. And it gets into pork and it infects the pork. So if you eat pork, how is pork supposed to be prepared? You are to cook it what? You're supposed to cook it well done. You're not supposed to have a rare pork. You're supposed to, why is it, do you think, that you're supposed to cook the pork thoroughly before you eat it? It's to kill the worms. I don't want them dead or alive. I don't know about you. This poor lady, she ended up with a brain tumor. Sorry, not a brain tumor, with a worm in her brain. It started with eating undercooked pork. God, I think, knew this. Just think of the pig. It is a scavenger. It'll eat anything, anything at all. They're not discerning eaters at all. Frequently, they just eat the garbage. You can feed them anything you want. You know that they're going to clean it up. Maybe God put them on the earth to clean up garbage. Maybe he didn't put them on the earth for us to eat and enjoy. Now, I know what somebody's, I know what you're thinking. Oh, this is all good and true, except he's got the wrong end of the stick. This is just for Jewish people. Except it's not just for Jewish people. Genesis 7, verse 2, unclean and clean. No Jews in Genesis 7. Look at this in Isaiah chapter 66. For behold, the Lord will come, that's future, with fire and with his angels like a whirlwind to render his anger with fury and his rebuke with flames of fire. Here we go. For by fire and by his sword, the Lord will judge all flesh, and the slain of the Lord shall be many. That's future still. That's future still. Those who sanctify themselves and purify themselves to go to the gardens after an idol in the midst, eating swine's flesh and the abomination and the mouse shall be consumed together, says the Lord. That's future. God is saying that swine's flesh, pork, whatever derivation of it is your thing, unclean and abomination, even future. So undoubtedly, this was never meant just for Jews. And why in the world would we think that God was only concerned about the health of Jews? Why would we think that? Oh, that's because we go by a restaurant and we smell that. But the Bible says man shall not live by aromas alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And you've seen what proceeds from the mouth of God. And if you're white knuckling it right now, wondering when will this be over, I'm not done yet. Leviticus 11, verse 9, these you may eat of all that are in the water. Whatever in the water has fins and scales, whether in the seas or in the rivers, that you may eat. Now, I do need to tell you, there's copious evidence for this, scientific evidence. I could talk about the time the Navy commissioned a study. If our sailors are stuck at sea, what should they eat? End of the day, they said, if it has fins and scales, tell them to eat that. If it doesn't, tell them not to. There's lots of scientific evidence for this. All in the seas or in the rivers that do not have fins and scales, all that move in the water or any living thing which is in the water, they are an abomination to you. So what does that include? Here we are in the South. That would include catfish. And that would include eels and crabs and, I don't know, all of that stuff. It includes it all. Lobster. Unclean according to the Bible. Now, you know, I mentioned earlier, look at berries. You just want to eat them. I never met a raspberry that I did not want to eat. Same with strawberries, blueberries. Oh, they're so good. They look good. But look at these guys. They look like they want to eat you. Berries don't look that way. They're just unattractive, these things. Maybe they're meant to be that way. They're saying, keep away from me, keep away from me. Anything with claws, anything with fangs, anything you have to defend yourself from, you probably shouldn't be eating it. And by the way, listen, if anyone knows what it is to eat this stuff, it's me where I'm from. If you can slow it down long enough to get a fork in it, it is fair game. But it's not God's way. And so you wonder, well, if we don't eat them, what are they for? These creatures serve a very good purpose. They are bottom feeders, and they feed from the bottom of the sea or the lake. That's what they do. Reminds me about a friend of mine. He had a friend. This was in Kentucky. He had cows everywhere. And you know that cows can be messy creatures. So the man would gather up the manure, dump it in the pond where he had it stocked with catfish, feeding frenzy. So if you ate one of his catfish, you were eating secondhand cow manure. I know a fellow who was a Navy diver. They trained him. They said, when you're looking for a body, look for a long line of crabs, because the crabs will be going for the dead body because they eat dead stuff. Pretty simple. You know, oysters, shellfish, are filter feeders. What they do is they suck in water, keep the impurities, and spit out cleansed water. In fact, when they were getting ready to clean up Chesapeake Bay up there towards Washington, D.C., the idea was to put in as many oyster beds as they possibly could, because one oyster can cleanse 50 gallons of water a day. I don't know how many oysters it would take to clean up Chesapeake Bay, but they knew that those little guys were sucking in the dirty water, keeping the impurities, and what they returned to the ocean was clean water. And so when the oyster has filtered out all the junk, where does the junk go? It ends up on your plate, and then you eat the oyster, interestingly enough, complete, whole, with the entire intestinal tract. Would you do that with a cow? I don't think you would, but you do it with an oyster. No, they weren't designed to be eaten by human beings. God said, were sin to come, I got a plan. We shall do something to mitigate against the dirty, dirty, polluted water. These little guys will help me to keep this earth somehow a little cleaner. Leviticus 11 and verse 13, let's go on. And these you shall regard as an abomination among the birds. They shall not be eaten. They're an abomination. The eagle, the vulture, the buzzard. The buzzard. Oh, there goes Thanksgiving. You were planning on serving a buzzard for Thanksgiving. Whoever did that? Look at that guy. He's beautiful in a certain sense, but beautiful in a really ugly way. You know what I mean? You're not going to eat a buzzard at Thanksgiving. Hey, come for Christmas. Grandma's cooking up a special vulture again. You just don't. You wouldn't. Now, I understand what someone's thinking, because I've heard it 1,000 times. Didn't that all change when Jesus died on the cross? By the way, Jesus died to cleanse sinners. He didn't die to cleanse catfish and oysters and pigs and snakes and cockroaches. That's not what he died for. A pig before the cross is absolutely the same after the cross. Nothing changed to make the pig clean. God was doing us a favor. Now, this is a test of your faith. Do you have enough faith to say, this is the will of God for my life too? It's interesting that we can change our beliefs sometimes. Oh, yeah, okay, I'm glad to learn that. But, you start touching what's on my plate, and you're spoiling for a fight there, mister. No, this is where faith comes into it. This is when you say, I had to cross this bridge. All right, well, if that's your will, I'm for it. And I get it, because I'll tell you this, I didn't plan to tell you this. When I was, 20, 21 years of age, I looked down and there was my dad laying on a hospital gurney. And they were wheeling him away to have triple bypass surgery. My dad ended up dying with congestive heart failure, and he earned it. I don't say that out of disrespect. He earned it all, every last bit of it. I realized, looking down at my dad on that hospital bed, I realized I was looking at my future. I lived the way my dad lived, ate what he ate, drank what he drank, lived the way he lived. Fast forward 30 years, that was gonna be me. No question about it. So when I realized that God was saying, I've got better for you, I knew it was a blessing. I know I'm gonna die someday, but I don't wanna die any sooner than I need to. And I don't wanna die from something I don't need to die from. And even more important, much more important, I want to honor God with my life. I may do that imperfectly, but when God says, this is the way, walk ye in it, what do you want to do? You want to follow God. No, it's not for Jews. The Jews' stomach functions just the same way as a Gentile's stomach. Good health is for all time, and it's important to get the victory over those practices that cause you damage, real damage. But there's always a what about. And the what about in this case is the vision or the dream that Peter had in Acts chapter 10. Let's look at it together. We're going to be careful. Too many times there is a tendency to allow one passage, one verse, one thought to unravel everything else the Bible says about a subject. And to allow that to happen would be to make a mistake. So let's see what's going on here. We'll read it carefully. Acts 10, starting in verse 9. Several verses we read, so hang in there with me. The next day, as they went on their journey and drew near the city, Peter went up on the housetop to pray about the sixth hour, about noon. He became very hungry, that's significant, and wanted to eat. But while they made ready, he fell into a trance and saw heaven opened, and an object like a great sheet bound at the four corners, descending to him and let down to the earth. In it were all kinds of four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, creeping things, birds of the air. A voice came to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "Not so, Lord, for I've never eaten anything common or unclean." A voice spoke to him again the second time, "What God has cleansed, you must not call common." This was done three times, and the object was taken up into heaven again. Now, Peter wondered within himself what this vision he'd seen meant. Behold, as he did so, the men who had been sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate. And they called and asked whether Simon, whose surname was Peter, was lodging there. Really interesting. So there's a few things we notice. Cornelius was a Gentile. God said, send somebody to Peter's house. Peter was a Jew. Jews believed Gentiles were unclean. In this vision, God says, rise, Peter, kill and eat. And Peter said, not doing that. I'm not eating unclean stuff. But this is several years after the cross. If the cross of Christ had changed the unclean, clean, unclean animals, Peter would have known, but Peter didn't know. And that's because there hadn't been a change. It's inconceivable that there would have been a change and Peter wasn't told. And here's what you notice. Rise, Peter, kill and eat. It happened three times. Why three times? Because Cornelius sent three men. And God said to Peter, what God has cleansed, don't call that common. What was it God had cleansed? God was declaring that Gentiles were clean and not unclean as the Jews believed them to be. Look in Acts 10 and verse 28. The Bible says, he said to them, this is Peter now. Peter's gone to Cornelius's house and he says, you know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to keep company with or to go to one of another nation. But God has shown me I should not call any what? Man. Common or unclean. He didn't say, I just had me a vision and God told me it's okay to eat pigs. He didn't say that. Peter opened his mouth and said, in truth, I perceive that God shows no partiality. God was declaring to Peter, Peter, I do not like racism. And you all are racist. You're bigoted. You look down on Gentiles. You believe that somebody like Cornelius is unclean. You would cross the road to avoid him, and you surely wouldn't share the message with him. But Peter, I'm giving you this vision, and in it you see that the things that I have cleansed, you are not to call common. And remember what he just said. We saw it six verses ago. God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. So this has nothing to do with pork or catfish or bacon or ham or sea cucumbers. Nothing. Wait, are they animal or a vegetable? I have no idea. I'm not going to eat it anyhow. Leave it in the ocean where it belongs. That's what I say. This had nothing to do with the menu and everything to do with Peter's bigoted heart. Remember that God said in the Psalms, no good thing will he withhold from them which walk uprightly. If it's a good thing, God wants you to have it. He wants you to enjoy it. The enemy wants to ruin you. He has a counterfeit for everything. He really has a counterfeit for God's good health plan. God's plan says, be judicious, be wise, eat the good, abstain from the harmful. The devil says, are you kidding me? Eat what you want, when you want, as much as you want, even though it's going to do you damage. For the believer, the Bible is the authority. The devil says, oh, don't be so simple. Let your taste buds be your authority. And the result is heart disease, cancer, strokes, diabetes, myriad illnesses. And then our minds aren't able to fully comprehend the blessings that God has for us. In this great conflict between good and evil, we are left as much easier pickings. We are privileged to be living on the edge of eternity. Jesus is soon to return. He's coming back soon, and he wants us to be ready. He wants us to be prepared and armed and strengthened, not weakened. God wants you to be with him forever. So in this world, there are some things that he wants us to leave aside, to leave behind. What we want, though, is to prepare ourselves for God as much as we can and to honor him with every facet of our lives. Paul wrote to the Romans, and he said, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And then he said, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You remember what Jesus said, love God with your whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. And when you do, you can expect God to do in you and for you that which you could never do yourself. We are in a battle for the mind. The next time we study together, we will talk about the United States in Bible prophecy. The temperature is going to get turned up in this world. We will then talk about the Antichrist of Bible prophecy, the mark of the beast, the final decisive, divisive issue that's going to come to this world. All of those things are serious. And God says, I want to give you a leg up. I want to give you strength that you might not otherwise have. I don't want you to be distracted by diseases and illnesses that you might want to avoid. God says to those who've been seriously ill or might be, I love you anyway. Hang on to me. He's not doing sheep and goats over whether we're well or not well. But he says to all of us, as far as you can honor me, do so. Whether you eat or drink, whatever you do, do it for the glory of God. What a privilege to have the opportunity to live lives yielded to the will of God. And as we walk further along this road, arm in arm with Jesus, you can expect to experience more and more of the blessing of God. He's coming back soon. Can you say amen? And we want to pray that by the grace of God, we'll be ready for that great day. Let us pray and ask God to do that work in our lives right now. Now, Father in heaven, many of us, there are things in our lives that we can't let go of that you need to take. We've discussed some of them tonight. Some addictive properties, some food or drink items. And we can grow very attached to these things. Lord, I'm praying that you'll have mercy on us and help us through. Further, Lord, there are deep in our hearts sins that we cannot shake. And we need you to enter in and take them away. Give us victories, Lord. Friend, tonight I need to ask you if there's a victory that you need in your life. Now, only God is watching. No one else. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. But is there a victory that you want to win? It could be physical, food, drink, diet. Sure, it could. Addiction could be. Might be something that goes deep, but in another way. Could be a spiritual weakness, a pet sin, something that you just don't seem to be able to expel from your life. God can do that. If there's something you want to bring to God right now, would you raise your hand? If there's something you would yield to God right now, would you lift up your hand? You're saying, God, see my hand, see my need, my great need. Only God knows what it is. God and you, Lord, tonight we surrender to you those things that we know we cannot beat, or those things where we need desperate help. And for some, I know there are some are raising hands in behalf of loved ones. Oh, Lord, I'm praying for this family member, this friend, this one close to me. I'm bringing that person right now. Help us, Lord. We're caught in a great spiritual battle. Do in us what we cannot do ourselves. Keep us, bless us, save us now and always and ever, we pray. In Jesus' name, please say with me, amen and amen.